Everybody seems to be dragging a little bit this morning. That's okay, because the word of the Lord, let it energize you. Our Mother's Day lesson today is not about mothers, so I don't want to disappoint you. We're going to talk about the feeding of the 5,000, or the feeding of the multitude. Only one of Jesus' miracles is recorded by all four evangelists, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. God chose to describe the person and the work of His Son from four different angles, four perspectives. Each author brings a unique point of view. And we thank Trish for reading the Matthew account. There's also a Mark account and a Luke account. They each bring a different account because each writes for a different audience. A different audience. Some events in Jesus' life are described by maybe two, sometimes three of the different Gospels. Sometimes, some of the events that Christ did are only talked about in one Gospel. But today's story, the miracle of the multiplication of the five small loaves of bread and the two fish, and as Christ transformed this snack into a feast for thousands, it's important to note that it is retold by all four Gospels. Now, some of you guys might have heard this argument. So in the last 50 years or so, it's become popular to claim that this was really no miracle at all. They said that it wasn't a miracle, but it was more of a giving in to peer pressure. To peer pressure. Now, what some of the arguments are, they said that thousands of men, they were hoarding food in their tunics. And when they saw this little boy come to Jesus to get everything he had, well, they felt guilty, they say. And at that point, they started giving out, they gave their food out, and they shared it with everyone. So everyone had just a little bit. Now, that's a cute story, isn't it? But it's utter nonsense. Utter nonsense. In fact, one reason every writer included this miracle is that it was so public and that it was so powerful as to make it undeniable. And it was an irrefutable statement that they make about Jesus' person and His ministry. Just like people have been trying to explain away the crucifixion, which is also utter nonsense.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
They attempt with this story as well. Before we get into today's sermon, let's take a moment to look at the roadmap we're going to take to get to our end destination today. First, we're going to look at the introduction. And what is the purpose of this story? Next, we're going to look at the characters of the story and ask the question, who are you most like? Who are you most like? And then, from there, we're going to look at the different types of faith that were demonstrated in this story. As we go to the segment of Let's Talk About Faith, we're going to look at pessimistic faith. We're going to look at optimistic but questioning faith. And we're going to look at positive faith. Are you ready for the journey?
Amen.
I am. Let's go. So, we've read the story of the feeding of the 5,000 many times. You probably heard this in Sunday school. You've heard it in VBS. You've heard it at Awanas if you went. You heard it in Word of Life Ministries if you did that. You've heard it in, what's some of the other kids? I mean, GAs probably, RAs. You've heard this story over and over and over. Why? Because we know it as one of the greatest miracles performed by Christ. In this passage, we see Christ is faced with the impossible. With the impossible. He's got two fish and five loaves of bread. And thousands of hungry people. We see that as impossible, don't we? Oh, but with Christ, through Him, all things
all
are
things.
Possible.
All things.
I love this story. Jesus miraculously fed, now get this, as many as some scholars predict, up to around 20,000 people. There were 5,000 men, and Matthew's testament goes ahead and tells us that included women and children. So they're guessing, estimating that it could have been close to 20,000 people that day were fed. And that happened despite the skepticism about feeding so many with the meager supplies that the disciples came up with. Various scholars have suggested five reasons why this miracle may have taken place. Now, there's probably more, but then let's just look at this five for a second. It says, first, to show his concern for the physical and well, or I'm sorry, let me say that again. To show his concern for physical as well as spiritual needs. Second was to strengthen the disciples' faith. They needed strengthening just as we do today. To prove his messianic claims. The Jews had a tradition that the Messiah would feed them just as Moses had done. We read that in Exodus this morning. And to show the value of small things when given to him to illustrate God's faithfulness. Let me ask you, church, this morning. What small things are you holding back because you see it as insignificant? As you see it as unnecessary, unfruitful, or just not enough? Think about that this morning as we go through this. The miracle led people to try to make Jesus king by force. Listen, they saw what happened. They got excited and they said, this is who we want for king. Let's take him by force. Let's do it now. Let's make him do it. Oh, but that wasn't God's design. God's design was not that Jesus manifest himself into an earthly king, but as a suffering servant who would give his life as a ransom for many. Please stand with me this morning as we read this great story from God's holy word, as we look at John chapter 6, verses 1 through 14. John chapter 6, verses 1 through 14. And God's word says, after these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. Then a great multitude followed him because they saw the signs which he performed on those who were diseased. And Jesus went up on the mountain, and there he sat with his disciples. Now the Passover feast of the Jews was near. Then Jesus lifted up his eyes, and seeing a great multitude coming toward him, he said to Philip, where shall we buy bread that these may eat? But this he said to test him, for he himself knew what he would do. Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one of them may have a little. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, there is a lad here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish. But what are they among so many? Then Jesus said, make the people sit down. Now there was much grass in the place. So the men sat down in number, about 5,000. And Jesus took the loaves. And when he had given thanks, he distributed them to the disciples. And the disciples to those sitting down. And likewise the fish, as much as they wanted. So when they were filled, he said to his disciples, gather up the fragments that remain, so nothing is lost. Excuse me. Therefore they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with fragments of the 5 barley loaves which were left over by those who had eaten. Then those men, when they had seen the sign that Jesus did, said, this is truly the prophet who is to come into the world. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this story. Lord, we thank you for what it means to each of us. Father God, to see your works and to see your power. Father God, I ask that you allow us to see it today in a fresh light. Lord, may we set aside any preconceived notions. Father God, may we set aside the things of the world today that are on our minds. Father God, today may we focus on you. Father God, may we have ears that truly hear and eyes that truly see. Lord, I thank you for the preparations that you've allowed me to do on this sermon. But Father God, I turn it over to you. Lord, may it be your words that come out. Lord, set me aside. Lord, may you be glorified. Father God, bless those who are listening today. Father God, bless those who may see this on the internet. Father God, may lives be touched because of your word, because of your actions. Lord, we love you and we thank you and we honor you today. And it's in your Son's Jesus' name that we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. You guys may be seated. And may God add to the reading of his holy word. Once again, this morning we have one of the most beloved stories in the entire Bible. Probably most of us have pictures of the event in our mind from children's stories, right? You guys remember it from your little days, for those who were in church. You remember from the lessons, you remember from the Sunday school stories. You remember it from the flannel graph board. Anybody remember that? I think Miss Trish has one set up in the children's place now. I don't think she has that particular story. You might though. But you remember from that, right? You remember the pictures were perfect and you could stick it on and the Sunday school teacher would tell the story and they would move things around and you had that visual, right? That's a good thing. That's a good thing. We want you to remember those things, but today we want to move beyond that and dig even deeper into the story. So on one hand, it's good that many of us are very familiar with this event. But on the other hand, it can almost be a hindrance. It could be a hindrance because we're so familiar with it that we think we know everything about it. We can easily, and we do, fall into the thinking that you can't teach me anything new. I've read this story, I've heard it from different angles. There's nothing here for me today. I'm going to go off and my mind's going to daydream. I'm going to think about what I'm going to do after church today and what meal we're going to eat. And I can visualize me cutting that big old steak. I'm not having a steak after dinner, after church today. But if I were, it's easy for our minds to wander. But I ask you, stay focused today. Listen to what the Lord's given you today. Maybe I won't tell you anything new. Maybe I will. It's up to the Lord. I give his words to him. If you're familiar with this passage, as many of us are, again, as odds are, I'm not going to tell you anything novel or new. But I'm going to do what I always try to do. I'm going to tell you what the text says. And I'm going to tell you how it applies to our lives today. After all, if this text didn't apply to us today, if it wasn't important, why would it be included in Scripture 4 times? Don't fall under the assumption that, man, I got food in my cabinet. I don't really get this story. I don't understand. I can't relate. It's in Scripture. It's for you. There will be a connection. Allow the Lord to take this and strengthen your faith through it. Now, as we get into the verses, or into the story, the first verse starts with the words, after these things. You guys catch that in verse 1? After these things. Now, that's a simple phrase. It's easy for us to go completely over and go, okay, what things? I remember the last story, but okay, it must be after that. But let's look at it a little closer. Remember that John is more concerned with a logical flow than he was with chronological flow. As a matter of fact, the events in chapter 6 took place somewhere between 6 months and a year. 6 months and a year after the events of chapter 5. So it was indeed after these things. And during that 6 to 12 months, between chapter 5 and 6, the other three Gospels make it clear that Jesus was having an extensive ministry in Galilee. He was preaching and he was teaching. He was also performing many miracles. Everywhere Jesus went, he was healing people and casting out demons and doing many miracles. Because of that, everywhere he went, a huge crowd followed. And as soon as people found out that Jesus was in the area, you can imagine what they did, right? Just like we would do. If you find out your favorite star is in the area, what do? We flock to him. We flock to him. Because we're fans. And I don't want to get off the subject, but many of these people that were flocking, they were fans of Jesus, amen, not followers. Excuse me. Now, as the people poured in, they would do this day and night because they wanted to see this what they considered the rock star Jesus, what they thought was going to be their earthly king that would come and save them from what was the issues they saw from the Romans. If Jesus wanted to spend time alone or just spend time with his disciples, he had to be very intentional about the way he could do it. Very intentional. And that's what was happening here in the first 3 verses of the passage. Jesus went to the eastern shore of the Sea of Galilee. And that's what it means in verse 1 when it says, over the Sea of Galilee. He was on the part of the shoreline that was fairly remote and desolate. He was looking to get away with his disciples. But the crowds followed him. So Jesus took his disciples up on a mountain. But the people followed him up there as well. And when they got there, they got more than they ever expected. As we examine this event, I want us to look at the event from the eyes of some of the characters. From the eyes of some of the characters involved. The first character was introduced in verse 2. Now you look at that and you go, I don't really see an individual there. And you're right. Because actually it's not an individual, it's a group. It's a group. Verse 2 calls this character a great multitude. We can call it today the crowd. And again, that's not an exaggeration either. This was a large group of people. Verse 10 says there were about 5,000 men. What we've read in Matthew is that it included men or women and children, because Matthew 14:21 says, that they had eaten were about 5,000 men besides women and children. Again, that means there were close to 20,000 people. Does anybody got a visual of how big 20,000 people is? Anybody? I mean, you can kind of picture, but take the community of Bristow. Okay? And that's more than just your neighborhood. That's a relatively large area, right? Add Noakesville to it. Not just the street, but the addresses of Noakesville is rather large also. Then head out my way and add built into it. And the census that I looked at said that was about 20,000 people right there. Does that give you a better vision of how many people were there? It's sometimes hard for us to picture these numbers because we don't deal with crowds that big very often. But there were a lot of people, and they were hungry. This was a massive crowd, and it was getting late. And their McDonald's was closed, and I don't know if it was Sunday. Chick-fil-A might have been closed. Who knows? Now, there was no other options for them. They would have to go back to town to get food. Now, when we think about being hungry, let's be honest. Is it really that big a deal for most of us? It's not. Listen, hungry for us means we just don't have what we want in our cabinet. Oh, there's food.
Amen.
I mean, you go to my house, we always got bread, we always got peanut butter. I may not want bread or peanut butter, but we always have food. So for us as Americans, we kind of sometimes struggle what it means to be really hungry. But I'm sure many of the people in that crowd today knew what it was really like to be hungry. I'm sure that many of them were needy people. This wasn't a rich area of the country. Galilee wasn't wealthy by any stretch of the imagination. So these people were in need of more than a snack. Plus the fact they had been chasing Jesus all around the countryside didn't help either. Listen, I walk a little bit, exercise a little bit. Man, my stomach starts growling and I'm ready to eat. These people walked everywhere. They spent a lot of energy. They were hungry. They were away from home. And it was getting late. And they were in physical need. In physical need. Now, it's easy to know when we're in physical need, isn't it? If you're in physical need, you do whatever it takes to meet that physical need or get it fixed. If you're sick, what do? You go to the doctor. You take medicine. You take coughs or whatever. If you're sick, you do whatever you can to try to get better. If you're cold, that's a physical need, right? You try to get warm. You may have to put on more clothes. You may have to crank the heater up. You may have to whatever. You do what you can to get warm. If you're hungry, you get something to eat. Now, it may not be exactly what you want, but you get something. The people knew that they had a physical need. So they were following the one who they thought could fix their need. In verse 2, it says they followed him because they saw his miracles, which he did, on all of them that were diseased. They saw the work of Christ. They knew he had power and miracles in him. The problem was, in church, this is sometimes where we stumble. The problem was they only knew that they were in physical need. They didn't even recognize that they were in spiritual need. Now, how do I know that? Is it two reasons? It's evident that Jesus was talking to them later on in the chapter. And I think Pastor Darren will preach on that in 2 weeks. But it's also evident because of the reason that verse 2 says that they were following Jesus. Why did they follow him? They followed him because they saw his miracles. They knew that they had physical needs and they were looking for someone to fix them up. They were looking for something for themselves. They were looking for what they could get out of it. They might have been following Jesus, but you can rest assured that they were looking at themselves the whole time. Jesus, they might have said, I'm following you because of what you can do for me. I'm following you for what I can get out of it. That was the crowd. They were the first character. The second character involved was Philip. Visual with me, but can't you picture that Jesus and the disciples sitting on the hillside? And listen, there was a peaceful breeze blowing, and the water, the lake was flat against the shore, making that peaceful sound, right? And off in the distance, they could just look out and see the beauty. And they were, we're spending time with our Lord. Things are quiet and peaceful for just a few minutes, though. And they look down the hill and they see people coming. And I can picture Jesus looking over to Philip and saying, Philip, here they come. What are we going to do? Did Jesus ask this question because he didn't know what to do? Of course not. Of course not. He asked the question in order to test Philip. And that's what verse 6 says. And as a matter of fact, just in case there were any questions, John made it perfectly clear in verse 6. And he says, and this he said to prove him, for he himself knew what he would do. Probably the right answer would have been, I don't know, Jesus. What do you think we ought to do? But Philip didn't do that, did he? What did Philip do instead? Philip engaged his brain. He engaged his brain and he disengaged his heart. Different people have different kinds of brains, don't we? And I think if you look at us three pastors, you can see that we all three think differently. That's not a bad thing. Some people have a philosophical, I'm mispronouncing that awfully, philosophical brain, right? And they like to take everything to a really deep level. That's probably you, Pastor Ricky, right?
Bingo.
that's good. We need people thinking that way. Some people have dramatic brains. They get all melodramatic and poetic about everything. This guy. Some people have mathematical brains, and they make good engineers and accountants or history majors, which is our pastor Darren. I think Philip had a mathematical brain. Look at his answer in verse 7. Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread is not sufficient for them. That every one of them have a little. In those days, if you had a good job, you might pull in 200 denarii in about an 8-month time frame. I don't know what caused Philip to come up with this number. Maybe that's how much money they had in their till. But for whatever reason, he chose that number. And the calculator in his brain began to click all around. And all he could come up with was, Jesus, we don't have enough money to feed all these people. If we completely drain our account, we won't have enough money to give all these people even a little scrap of food. If nothing else, Philip was being practical. He was a realist. He saw the number of people. He saw the amount of money, and he knew what could be brought for that much money. And he came to the only reasonable conclusion he could come up with. Anybody remember what it is? It can't be done. It can't be done. Jesus, listen, Jesus, you might be interested in feeding these people. This is Philip talking. But Jesus, I'm here to tell you, it can't be done. But there's another character in our story. And that character was Andrew. Listen, you gotta love Andrew, don't you? We don't see him a whole lot in Scripture, but But every time we see him, he's introduced the same way. And he's doing the same thing. He's always introduced as Peter's brother. Peter's brother. For those of you who may have a brother or sister who's more famous than you, you could probably relate to Andrew. Hey, here's Andrew.
Who?
You know, Andrew. Philip's brother. Yes, Philip's brother. Oh, him. Yeah. So that's the way it was with Andrew. He was always introduced as Philip's brother. As Peter's brother. Forgive me for that. But also notice he's always doing the same thing. And this is what I love about Andrew. He's always bringing somebody to Jesus. Do you guys realize that? That's why many times, if you go to a church and they have a visitation program set up, they call it Operation Andrew. Operation Andrew, because he's always bringing people to Christ. And that's what he's doing here as well. Verse 8 in the first part of verse 9 says, one of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, there is a lad here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish. Now, we talked about it before, but just for a minute, you need to get the flannel graph picture out of your mind. Kind of let that go away for a second. The boy didn't just present himself out of thin air. On our flannel graph, what do? We bring it, stick it to the board, and he's there, right? Let that go. Andrew had to go looking for him. Jesus wants the people to be fed. Andrew immediately heads off into the crowd of about 20,000 people. And he's looking for food. And out of all those people, the only one he can find is this boy. This boy. This young lad. This young boy whose mama wouldn't let him leave the home without his lunch bucket that morning. Andrew tenaciously tracked this boy down and brought him to Jesus. And if he left it at just that, it would have been good. But what did he do? We read on and says, here, Jesus, I brought someone who has some food. But Andrew didn't do that, did he? That's what he should have said. Here, Jesus, I brought you someone who has some food. But what did he do? He finished verse 9 and he said, but what are those? What are they among so many? Listen, that but word will get us in trouble all the time.
It sure will, preacher.
But I hear what you're telling me to do, Christ, but it'll get you every time. Now, Andrew was sensitive to what Jesus wanted. What I also love about Andrew was a man of action. If you notice that in the scripture, Andrew was, when asked for something, he did it. Jesus said food. What did Andrew do? He went and got food. He brought everything he could and presented it to Jesus. And then he said, but Jesus, it's not enough. It's not going to work. Jesus, if we just had more food, it would work. But if we just had more, we could do what you're wanting to do. But it just won't work. If we had just a little more, then we could really do something. But all we have is this little bit, this insignificant bit. What good is that going to do? That was Andrew. But let's not forget the fourth character involved, the boy. If I were to ask you to tell me everything you know about this boy, what would you say? Not much. Not much. Because there isn't much to say. First, the original word translated lad indicates that he was a child. He was a child. He's a child with a child's lunch. Now, don't get the wrong impression of the loaves and the fish. You know, what do we think? We think about the homemade bread that's, you know, the big old chunk of bread. And if he's got fish, obviously he'd been out fishing. So we're not talking small, because this was biblical times. They had big fish back then, right? One big enough to swallow a man. So this lad, it must have had a huge lunchbox, but no, once again, get rid of your flannel graph picture. That wasn't it. They weren't 5 full loaves of bread. They were more like biscuits. and the fish were probably more like cured sardines. Anybody like to eat sardines? Absolutely nasty. In case you do, I'll just throw that out there. That's free. But you're probably talking small pieces of fish. Now, they would typically use these small pieces of fish, and they'd use it like a spread that they would spread on the dry biscuits. This wasn't rich people food. This is food that poor people ate. And because he was a little boy and there were five biscuits, that means the food was supposed to last him for a while. I don't know if you've ever been poor enough that you didn't know where your next meal was coming from. But if you have, you know it wasn't a casual thing for the boy to give up what he had, his food. But he did. He was a child. He was poor. He was so insignificant that Scripture doesn't even record his name. An insignificant, poor child. All he had was a few biscuits and a couple of sardines. But what did he do with them? He willingly, catch that word, willingly gave them to Jesus. He wasn't like the crowd. He wasn't looking for something out of it. He wasn't like Philip. He wasn't calculating ways that it wasn't going to work. He wasn't even like the one who brought him to Jesus, Andrew. He wasn't looking for anything else. He brought Jesus everything he had. He was just looking for what Jesus was going to do with it. What Jesus was going to do with the little bit that he brought, which is all he had. And notice what Jesus did. This is important. He did four things. He put the people in the position of expectation. In verse 10, it says that Jesus told the disciples to make the people sit down. Make them sit down. Now, the word literally means to recline. Reclining was the position that they ate in. Jesus had the crowd assume the position of eating. In other words, get your fork, get your spoon, get your hands ready, get your plate ready. Hey, get ready to eat. Jesus, they might have said, there isn't any food. Doesn't matter. Jesus put them in the position of expectation. Then in verse 11, what did Jesus do? And after putting the people in a position of expectation, he gave thanks for the provision that was yet to come. He gave thanks. He blessed the food that wasn't there yet. Oh, that was the small portion. But for what was to come, he gave thanks for it. Then it was only after that Jesus blessed the unbelieving crowd with food. Verse 11 says, as much as they wanted. They ate until they were stuffed. Listen, go to Golden Corral or any other buffet. You know what it feels like to be stuffed, or any of the Chinese buffets. Man, last time Jeff and I went to the place, we ate so much we were miserable. And we still shoved sushi down just because it was there. So that's gluttony. Forgive me, Father. But that's kind of what they ate until they were full. Can you imagine what it felt like if you struggled to get food to eat until you wanted no more? Can you imagine the excitement you must feel to know that you don't have to conserve, you're eating until you're full? Notice what Jesus did for his disciples. He gave each of them a basket of bread to feed their faith. Now, these weren't little baskets. They were large baskets they normally used for transporting fish. So each one of the disciples gathered up a couple of bushels of bread to take with them and munch on for the next several days. As this story continues to develop, we see Christ's concern for meeting the needs of man, included something as basic as physical hunger or a missed meal. We would do well to remember that there is no need that we may have that Jesus does not want to meet. In his response to meet the physical need of the multitude, Jesus used the occasion to strengthen his disciples' faith. Verse 6 tells us that even though he knew what he would do, he asked this question in order to test or to prove, thereby teaching the disciples a tremendous lesson of faith. Faith. As we begin to wrap this message up, let's talk about faith specifically for a few minutes. And let's talk about the three types of faith that are demonstrated here in this story. First, there's pessimistic faith. Pessimistic faith. This is the faith that we observe in Philip. Philip had faith. Understand that. Philip had faith. But Philip had faith that was despairing and almost hopeless. When Jesus asked Philip, "Where shall we buy food for all these people?" Remember how Philip answered earlier? He said, 200 denarii of bread was not sufficient for them, that every one of them may have a little. Philip had a pessimistic faith. His faith only saw the multitude. His faith only saw the problem. But notice this, guys. He was not faithless. He was not faithless. But his faith was pessimistic. Let's analyze Philip's faith just a little bit. He believed in God. His faith believed that Christ was the Son of God. His faith believed that Christ has the power to meet the needs of man. His faith even witnessed Jesus' past miracles. And when a problem arose, his immediate response of his pessimistic faith was to see the problem and not the power of God. Philip's faith didn't see the opportunity for the power of God to be demonstrated in conquering the problem or bearing a strong testimony. In the crisis of the problem, pessimistic faith seems to forget about the power of God. A pessimistic faith sees money, it sees human resources, or that which is visibly available. But it fails to see God and His ability. It stresses the hopelessness and the impossibility of a situation. Here's a question to each of you. Do you have pessimistic faith? Do you see the problem more than you see the power of God? Do you see Surrender Baptist Church as just this small church that, well, we really can't do much? The problem is we're too small. No. The answer is my God is big enough. Do you have pessimistic faith? Secondly, in addition to pessimistic faith, we see the other type of faith that we see in the miracle, and that's optimistic faith. It's good on the surface. And verse 8 and 9 says, once again, one of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There's a lad here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish." See the optimism? Oh, but then we come to the questioning faith. But what are they among so many? I see a solution, but we really can't do it. You guys see where Andrew was coming from?
Uh-huh.
Andrew's faith demonstrated optimism mixed with doubt. He had an optimistic but questioning faith. Now, Andrew loved Jesus, and he was committed to him. He saw the Master's concern for the people, and he responded by going among the crowd and searching for food. He found and gathered all the resources he could. An optimistic faith lies in what it can be found, what it can find before the Lord. The barley bread was the cheapest bread that could be made or brought. It was anything but a delicacy. The 2 fish, as we talked about, were small as sardines. A simplistic, optimistic faith of Andrew had searched and found what was available. Two small barley cakes and 2 small fish. And he offered what he had found to the Lord. But the optimism came with questions. But what are they among so many? But what are they among so many? The optimistic faith is a questioning faith. Too often the questions take a downward path and undermine the optimism, just like it did with Andrew. A questioning faith complains about the problem. We're too small again. We don't have enough resources. We don't have enough time. We don't. Questioning faith complains about the problem. It's also anxious about meager resources. You know, we can reach this whole community, but what is it amongst just a few of us? It grumbles over small provisions, if we only had more. And it gripes over poor quality. And after looking at the limited resources and the poor quality of the supply, the questioning faith doubts God. It questions God instead of believing God to take care of the problem. Whether there's a need for food, good health, money, deliverance, or any other human need, Jesus wanted us to learn this fundamental lesson from this miracle. Trust Christ. Trust Christ. Let's take it one step further. Don't doubt. Trust Christ. Don't doubt. Don't doubt His power, His wisdom, His care, and His love for us. And finally, in addition to pessimistic and optimistic but questioning faith, there is positive faith. This is a faith in God that is positive, unequivocal, and unswerving. This is the faith that Jesus demonstrated. Look at Jesus' faith. He took what He had. 5 small biscuits, 2 small sardines. And He gave thanks to God for it. You can imagine that this little boy's lunch could probably fit in the hand and the palms of the master. But notice what He did not do. He did not stand there looking at the insufficiency of what He had. You know, look down, look at the problem. Look down at the insufficiency, look at the problem. He didn't do that. He did not question or complain with hopelessness, wondering, how is this need ever going to be met? Instead, He looked up and He gave thanks unto the giver of every good and perfect gift. The small supply and the poor quality didn't matter. What mattered was He had something, that there was some provision. A gift, a sacrifice, a resource, small though as it was, that had been given and laid at His feet for the Lord to use as He willed. So with gratitude, Jesus took it and He lifted it up to God. And He gave thanks, trusting God to meet the need of the hour. Church, what are we doing? What are you doing with your small provisions? Are you holding it up, saying it's not enough? Are you looking at it as excuses why we can't do things? Or are you turning it over to the Lord and saying, take this. This is the best that I have. It may not be good quality, God, but it's the best I got. Do with it as You will. Not as I will, but as You will, Father. Jesus' faith was positive and perfect. He knew beyond any question that God would supply the need of the multitude with the resources He had. He simply gave what He had, and God did the rest. That's all any of us can do. Give all we have, what we hold in our hands. And the lesson that Jesus taught with this miracle is that while you are giving, you must also trust the power and the provision of God. How do I know this? Because this miracle in John 6 is not so much a message about receiving, but it is about giving. The little boy gave his lunch. The disciples gave it to Jesus. Jesus gave thanks to God. Jesus gave the food to His disciples, and the disciples gave food to the multitude. And after gathering up the 12 baskets full of fragments, Jesus gave them to the disciples. It's not about what we have. It's about what we let God do with what we have. As we bring this to a close, missionary statement Hudson Taylor. He had complete trust in God's faithfulness in his journey. And in his journey he wrote. And there's a picture of Hudson. I've looked on the internet to find many pictures of him. He wasn't smiling in any of them. I guess that's the way they took pictures back then, but he wrote, "Our Heavenly Father is an experienced one. He knows very well that his children wake up with a good appetite every morning. He sustained 3 million Israelites in the wilderness for 40 years. We do not expect he will send 3 million missionaries to China, but if he did, he would have ample means to sustain them all. Depend on it. God's work done in God's way will never lack God's supply." Let me read that one more time in case you daydreamed on me. "God's work done in God's way will never lack God's supply." God met the need of the 5,000 in spite of the pessimistic faith of Philip and the optimistic but questioning faith of Andrew. God met the need because of the positive and unswerving faith of Jesus. God saw the need of the multitude and he filled it. And he filled them. In fact, he more than met their need. The Bible says that there were provisions left over, 12 baskets full that we read about. Now someone may ask, why 12 baskets? Well, maybe it was because there were 12 disciples, 12 servants who had labored in obedience to Christ and waited on the 5,000 men, plus their wives and their children. Each servant left with a supply of food that would last for days. God always provides abundantly for his true servants. And Philippians 4:19 tells us, "But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus." Now, be careful here. Don't take this as a health and wellness message. I'm not saying that at all. I'm not saying that by following Christ you're going to become rich one day. If you give to the offering, you're going to get it all back tenfold. That if you give to the ministry, that God's going to come and bless you beyond me. I'm not talking about that. Sometimes your needs are met in ways that you may not quite understand. Sometimes after the long battle with cancer, sometimes death is the answer.
It is.
Now, we don't like that answer. But man, what an abundant answer that is, Pastor Ricky. To be in the presence of Christ. "But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus." Do you know that the same Jesus that we read about in this story, the same Jesus who did the miracles, is the same Jesus who is walking in our midst this morning? He is the same Jesus the Scripture tells us is the head of the body, the church. That's who Jesus is in this church today, in case anybody doesn't know. He is the head of this church. We're a church that exists to serve him. Now let me ask you, who are you in this church this morning? Are you the crowd? Have you come here just this morning because you're looking for what you can get out of it? Are you simply here to have your needs met? Maybe you're more like Philip this morning. You know what Jesus is asking you to do? Or us to do as a church? But you look around and say, there's no way. There's no way. Listen, I see the vision. I understand, pastors, where you think we need to go, but we're going to have a hard time paying our bills, much less reaching this area for Christ. Is that you this morning? Have the resources? Has the problems caused your faith to be pessimistic? Maybe you're more like Andrew this morning. You worked hard and you brought Jesus everything you can find. But when you laid it down in front of him, thinking that Jesus just needs more stuff to accomplish his will. I've given him what I had, but it's not enough. It's not enough. We could be a really good church. We could be a really great church if we just had, fill in the blank. If we just had more room, if we just had a better children's area, if we just had a better nursery, if we had 2 bathrooms back here, if we had a Frappuccino machine behind the desk, we could be a really great church if we just had. be a really great church when we give to Christ all that we have.
That's good.
And let Him do what He sees fit by His will.
That's good.
Now, you might have walked in here this morning like any one of the characters. Here's what I'm asking you now. I'm asking you to leave here like the little boy. I'm asking you to leave here like the little boy. You don't have to be anybody. You don't have to have anything. I'm asking you to turn over whatever you have to Jesus. This isn't about your offering. Yeah, we're going to take up offering after a while. I'm not asking you to empty your bank account. That's not what I'm talking about here. What I'm talking about here is your life. I'm talking about your life. This is about Jesus being Lord over every area of your life. Maybe you need to publicly profess Him this morning. Maybe you don't know Him as your personal Lord and Savior yet. Maybe you need to follow His commands and be baptized. Do you remember back in what Jesus did back in verse 5? When He saw the crowds coming, He looked over to Philip and basically said, "You know what needs to be done." He looked in, I can imagine him looking in the eye and saying, "What are you going to do about it? You see the problem coming, Philip. What are you going to do about it?" This morning, you know what needs to be done. And I'm asking each of you, what are you going to do about it? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, may we be like the little boy. Lord, we don't know his name. But Father God, we see his heart. Lord, he came with just a little food. Probably the only food he'll have for a while. And Father God, he gave it to your son, Jesus. Do with as he willed. Father God, may we all come to your throne this morning with the faith of that little boy. Father God, may we not focus on the problem that seems too big or the resources which seem like too little. But Father God, may we focus on your will. May we focus on turning what we have over to you and letting you do your work. Father God, help each of us as we evaluate our lives this morning. Are we like Philip, who sees it and says it's not enough? Are we like Andrew, who's excited, who's willing to go, and he finds it, and he goes out and tenaciously does your work, but then he says, it's not enough? Or are we like the crowd, who struggles with truly following you, who only sees what they can get and not what they can give? Father God, I think each of us fall into one of those categories this morning. And Father God, we pray that you transition us from that into the faith of the little boy. And Lord, may we serve you with that power. Lord, may we serve you with all that we have. Father God, may we get our spiritual priorities in order. Father God, I thank you for Surrender Baptist Church. Lord, I thank you that for right now in our season that we're a small church and that we have limited resources. I thank you for that, Father God, because I know you're going to do big things with them. Father God, I know that you're going to reach lost people because of this church. Father God, use us how you see fit. Father God, don't allow us to stand in your way. But may we focus on what you're going to do. May we give thanks in advance. May we get in the position of expectation. Father God, we thank you. Have your will and way with us. And Father God, if there's someone who's struggling in our church today, Father God, if there's someone who just needs to get on their knees and just talk to you this morning, Father God, may today be the day that they come to terms with their walk with you. And Father God, if there's someone in here who, Lord, they realize they really don't know you. They realize that they really don't have a relationship with you. Father God, may today be the day that you call them. And may today be the day that they listen. Father God, may we not take Christianity as a game. But may we always walk in the Spirit with the thought of the eternal life with you. Father God, we love you and thank you. We just ask you to be with the words we're about to sing, Lord, as we open up the altar. For it's in your Son's blessed and holy name we pray. Amen.